Good evening. It's difficult to follow such good speakers, and my topic may sound a little dry or academic, but don't worry, I'll speak briefly, I hope, and perhaps some of you will find it interesting. So my topic is the need for respectful dialogue on honor-based violence. When I first started working on honor-based violence 4 to 5 years ago, I encountered considerable reluctance on the part of people I would have conversations with about this. I would say, do you know, I think this is a topic that we ought to be working on at the Schumer Foundation. We ought to be thinking about honor-based violence. And the body language was pulling back. It was, you know, don't want to hear about this, don't want to talk about it. People were really afraid of the issue, it seemed. And my sense is that's not so much still the case, but I know there's still a great deal of awkwardness. So I'll say a little bit about why I think we do need to have dialogue on honor-based violence and why it has to be respectful. Because I think Canadians have to be willing to talk about our differences. We are, as a society, committed to gender equality. I think it was already stated, as we all know, gender equality is guaranteed by the Charter of Rights, and so many other authority figures speak to us all the time about gender equality. So how then do we deal with the view that some people bring to Canada that girls and women are not entitled to equality, and in particular, they're not entitled to enjoy the kind of freedom that boys and men do? Diversity is wonderful. As Canadians, we're very fortunate that we live amongst such diversity, and our lives are so much richer and better for it. But, and this is what gets us in right immediately into controversial territory, not all aspects of cultural diversity are harmless. Some differences, if they were adopted in our society, would undermine human rights advances that have been made in Canada. And I think most Canadians, it's quite evident, most Canadians don't want to lose those advances, such as equality for girls and women, protection for gay rights, and protection for rights of the disabled. But we need to be vigilant that we don't slip backwards by appearing to condone or by not dealing very well with practices that run counter to our ideals, such as gender equality. Now, I recognize that talking about some social or cultural practices as being better than others is controversial, and thus I'm in tricky territory here. But we are, at the Sheldon Schumer Foundation, an ethics and leadership foundation, and we take this need to talk in a serious way about ethics very seriously. But I would insist that even though these conversations are difficult, that we need to have them. Because some practices are more humane or ethical, and some are less so. Take, for example, gay rights. In some countries, gays are persecuted and harassed, and violence is perpetrated against them just because they're gay. And we know sometimes it happens in North America, too. In some countries, even public officials, elected and appointed, call for the killing of gay people just because they are gay. In some other countries, on the other hand, including Canada, fortunately, there are laws to protect gays from discrimination. And gays and everybody else, we have freedom of speech, freedom of association, including the ability to form NGOs like the Rona Amir Foundation, like the Sheldon Schumer Foundation, and others, to promote human rights. And we have freedom of assembly, which allows us to come together like this tonight and talk about things, even though there'd be a lot of people who would wish we would not do that. So is one system better than another? Is a system that protects human rights and civil liberties better than a system that does not? Well, of course it is. Why would anybody doubt that? And yet there is a whole school of thought, and I'd be very surprised if none of you knew of it. There's a whole school of thought that says, no, you can't say things like that. You can't do that. You can't criticize one culture's or society's ethics from outside that culture because all ethics are relative to a cultural framework. Some of you are nodding your head in agreement, which is either means you've just heard of it or else you actually agree with it. But anyway, this view is called ethical or cultural relativism, and I just said what it is. That is, I as Canadian cannot criticize something that goes on in another culture, and even if I'm a mainstream Canadian, I can't criticize right, subcultures in, within Canada. So, for example, and if you adhere to relativism, then this is what you think, but it is a self-defeating argument. If you say, I can't criticize female genital mutilation, for example, as it is practiced in Egypt and it's practiced in a number of countries, if I can't criticize that as practiced in Egypt as a violation of women's rights because it's practiced outside my culture, then it must also be wrong. Think about what you're committed to. It must also be wrong for Egyptians to criticize Canadians for some of our practices, such as our very bad environmental practices, our very high per capita consumption of energy and the like. So some people think they're being very progressive because they're being non-judgmental when they say all ethics are relative. But in fact, it completely defeats the whole ethical exercise, right? We can't make ethical progress unless we can say that one practice is better than another from an ethical point of view. I might be wrong in my judgments, you might be wrong in your judgments, but it's not crazy to have those judgments, and we have to be able to talk those through. So when I said that several years ago, when I would meet with my progressively minded friends and say, I think this is a topic we have to get involved in, or I want our foundation to get involved in, that's what they were doing. They were trying to get away from me and trying to get away from that topic, not because they didn't think it was important. They weren't comfortable talking out loud in the way that I've just been doing so in making judgments. Now, here tonight we may be largely talking to the, what's it, preaching to the choir, talking to the converted, but it is sometimes a view that you encounter. And there are, of course, we could give each other any number of other contexts, not just the gender equality context, where we run into the same problem. You can talk about it in religious context, you can talk about it in many others. But I'll just sort of cut it short at this point. We do, I think, have to be able to talk about the personal freedom of girls versus boys, and we have to talk about that sense of family honor that is sometimes the motivating factor behind some pretty gross forms of discrimination against girls and women. Now, that's about having the conversation. We have to have the conversations, even though they're awkward and they can often make me feel really uncomfortable. But we also have to make them respectful. And this is tricky in itself. I think these conversations, we have to have them and they have to be respectful. We have to discuss the issues respectfully, not because all beliefs, opinions, and practices are equally worthy of respect. They're not. Those of you that were nodding your head in agreement with me agree that they're not. The view that gays deserve to die because they are gay is a belief that's not worthy of respect. The view that I'm not entitled to the same rights as a male is not worthy of respect in my view. But the people that hold them sometimes hold them indeed very sincerely, and we have to engage with them respectfully. We have to treat people with respect, but not necessarily respect what they say and what they believe and, of course, what they sometimes do. Some people may sincerely regret that they have to kill their daughters because they spoke to a young man from outside the family or wore sexy clothing or whatever. I'll just give you an example that was passed on to me by a Calgary police officer. It was not Simon, but another officer who ran into a person actually in a police facility, I won't make it any more specific, in a police facility sobbing away. This man was sobbing in tears. Policeman approaches him. He says, well, you know, what's the problem? He knew him. He was maintenance staff in one of the police buildings. And the man didn't want to tell him, and finally this police officer prevailed on, tell me, you can tell me what's so bad that you're crying in this public spot. And he said, my relatives tell me I have to kill my niece, and I don't want to. So this man was thoroughly distraught, brokenhearted, because the extended family was putting pressure. He was the one that had been appointed to do the dirty work. So people do sincerely believe such things sometimes. So we have to understand that it's a terrible thing that's happening to them as well. And people may hold these regressive beliefs because they've had no education to speak of, neither formal education much, nor any broad experience of the world. And they may, if they happen to think some of these actions, honor-based violence, is compelled by their religion, they don't actually know what their religion, the tenets of their actual religion. So we have to treat people with dignity and respect, also for a pragmatic reason. And that is that to not do so, as we all know, can invite backlash and can make matters even worse. To approach people who hold the view, for example, that their daughters are not entitled to the same educational opportunities as their sons, with a dismissive or disrespectful attitude, may just turn them off and make them more resistant to women's and girls' equality than they were before. I think it's one thing to say what I'm saying, that we have to have these conversations and they have to be respectful. I think it's not at all easy, and I think that's why these conversations do not happen often enough. And I want to close by saying just one thing, which I always take for granted, but experience has taught that I should say explicitly. The fact that a society like ours is more advanced in some ways, specifically in terms of human rights protections, does not mean that it's more advanced in all ways. There is no need to condemn whole cultures or elevate whole cultures, holus bolus. But we do have to recognize that many people who come to our country come from places where the equality rights of women, equality rights of gays, transsexuals, and simply equality rights across the board are much more poorly protected. And we want not to lose the advances that have been made in the human rights area, so we need to stand up for the things that we think are so important, and not just in the sense of demanding laws, not just in the sense of changing or strengthening public policy, but in interpersonal exchanges, and that's so very difficult, and I find it difficult too. So thank you for your attention.